Hi, my name is Peter Glick. I'm a social psychologist at Lawrence University, and I'm going to be talking to you about some of the discriminatory processes that can lead to underrepresentation of women in STEM fields or undermine their performance in some ways. So I just want to start off with asking that question, does gender bias exist in STEM? And a recent study published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science suggests that in fact, yes, there is gender bias in STEM. They looked at R1 STEM faculty, both male and female, and these faculty members were given a resume to evaluate for somebody applying for a lab manager job, and the big manipulation was whether the applicant was John or Jennifer, so either a male or a female name. And people rated the applicant in terms of their competence, hireability, and whether they would spend a lot of time mentoring them. And what was found was that on all three of these measures, male applicants were rated more highly than female applicants, significantly more highly. And of course, when it comes down to choosing one person for a job, that can be quite a big deal. Now, interestingly, the gender of the faculty members making these judgments didn't matter, so women discriminated as well as men, and this suggests that maybe some of these processes are not just in-group bias, but unconscious processes that affect all of us. It also was a big deal that the stuff on the left is remaining the same, except for that one additional bullet point, recommended salary, and as you can see in this graph, the male applicant was awarded a projected salary of almost $4,000 a year more than the female applicant. So this really is a significant kind of discrimination, both in hiring and what you would pay the person. All right, well, so the assumption here, there's not a lot of studies that specifically target STEM and show discriminatory processes. There's a lot of organizational and lab studies that show these processes. And our assumption as social psychologists is that the underlying processes are similar when you get into masculine fields. So I'm going to be talking about studies that sometimes are lab studies, sometimes take place in other kinds of industries. But the assumption is going to be that you still get some of the same dynamics, that stereotypes are stereotypes. They operate in similar ways. And what I'm going to emphasize is material based on my own work with Susan Fisk at Princeton that looks at some subtle causes of discrimination, because you probably are good at monitoring some of the more hostile expressions of sexism, but we've also studied what we call benevolent sexism. Now, this may sound like an oxymoron, but I will be explaining to you why it's not. These are paternalistic attitudes that view women as nice, but really not competent in masculine fields, right? So benevolent sexism is a problem, because I'll show you that it supports and justifies hostile sexism, which is the more derogatory attitudes, that they go kind of hand in hand. It leads to patronizing discrimination. Discrimination that feels like affection and might lead to a lot of praise and pats on the head, but actually discriminates against women when it comes to giving them tangible resources. For instance, like promotions, pay, resources, lab resources, things like that. And this, of course, in turn limits women's opportunity and development, but it also even undermines their actual performance. So being treated in a benevolent, a seemingly benevolent but patronizing way actually has more effects in some ways on women's performance than the more hostile kind of treatment. Oh, by the way, I forgot to mention at the beginning that if you want to ask questions, you can do that during this talk. I will answer them at the end, but you're free to type in questions as we go along. Finally, benevolent sexism is a problem because although it seems nice, and in fact the person delivering this kind of patronizing treatment may think that they are being nice, it tends to, if resisted, elicit a hostile backlash. So there again, the hostile part of sexism goes along in some ways with benevolent sexism. And I'll be, this is sort of a roadmap to the presentation, and I'll be getting into the details, of course, now. Okay, so what is benevolent sexism? I call it BS for short. Benevolent sexism really comes out of what I will call the central gender relationship paradox. Across the world, on various measures, men dominate. So when you look at the top of hierarchies, for instance, or resources, men have more or are higher up than women overall. In fact, when you get to the top of the hierarchy, whether in government, like senates and parliaments or presidencies, or you look in industries, CEOs of Fortune 500 companies, although there's been a lot of progress toward gender equality across, especially in Western industrialized nations, when you look at the top of the hierarchy, it looks a little bit more like the 50s than you might expect. It looks like there hasn't been very much progress. However, this male dominance coexists with something that's not true typically between other groups. Men and women are intimately interdependent. So because of heterosexuality, which remains very popular, men and women rely on each other and need each other, and men, then this leads men, being both the dominant group, really being dependent in some ways on women. So just one way of thinking about this is I always point out there will not, heterosexual men will not conduct a genocide against all women because they want women to be around. They might want to control women, but at the same time, they don't want to eliminate women. Or as Henry Kissinger put it, nobody's going to ever win the battle of the sexes because there's too much fraternizing with the enemy. So if you think about this, then there's a paradox that has to be resolved by sexist ideology. And that's what ambivalent sexism theory talks about. And it suggests, we suggest, Susan Fisk and I suggest, that this stems from structural factors in the relations between men and women, that male dominance combined with interdependence between the sexes leads to two types of sexist attitudes. Male dominance leads in a straightforward way to hostile sexism. Whenever a group dominates over other groups, they tend to justify that dominance. So they tend to see the other group as less competent, less deserving. They tend to basically put down the subordinated or disadvantaged group. This is especially directed and especially hostile toward people who want to rock the boat. So, for instance, you can think of highly negative attitudes toward feminists or women who pursue power and ambition because they threaten to overturn this male dominance. At the same time, again, there's this intimate interdependence, and what we suggest is that sexist attitudes resolve this kind of almost contradiction between dominance and interdependence through benevolent sexism. So what is benevolent sexism? I'll define it a little bit more now. It's a subjectively positive attitude toward women. It's this idea that women are wonderful. They're warm, they're nurturing, we need them, we can't live without them, but only as long as they comply with ideals of how they're supposed to be and they serve men's needs. So you can think of this women as romantic objects, women as moms, women as people who take care of the home, take care of the family. These are all very, very subjectively positive attitudes, but benevolent sexism is when these attitudes, these positive attitudes, are contingent on women staying in their place. One way you can think of this is that benevolent sexism is the carrot that rewards women who remain in traditional roles, and hostile sexism is the stick, and that's the stick that comes out to punish women when they don't stay in their place, when they question the status quo or they seek greater equality or power, then you get the stick. So you can see this really as a coordinated system, right? If you want to effectively rule over subordinates, it's a good idea to have both rewards that you trickle down when they comply and punishment when they don't. So here we can see some sample items, and you can see we measure this through self-report items, agree, disagree format, and these are just some items on the hostile sexism scale, and you can see that they have a very competitive kind of attitude about, again, you think of the battle between the sexes, that women are in a struggle for power with men. If you look at the benevolent sexism items, they have a very, very different tone. They're very much more subjectively positive, although they are, in a way, very old-fashioned. They really idealize women set women on a pedestal, but that pedestal is very narrow and very easy to fall off. So it suggests that men really need to provide for women, protect women, and be affectionate toward women, even revere women, but only so long as they stay in traditional roles, right? Which is not being a, for instance, a top scientist is not a traditional role. So we've looked at these attitudes across many nations, so more than two dozen, in very large cross-national studies. And you can see that we've covered a good part of the world through colleagues collaborating with us in various nations. So I just want to show you that, there's a lot of research on this. And a couple of basic effects that I want to show you. So one is that when you look across cultures and you compare across cultures, you find that within samples, so now these are correlations that I'm showing you. So these are not means that are graphed on the graph, but rather degree of correlation. And what this shows you is that among individuals, so if you take any sample, so from, say, the US, you take a sample of people, and you measure hostile and benevolent sexism, the chances are that the correlation between those two attitudes is a positive one at about 0.4. So that's roughly where the it tends to average out. In other words, people who endorse hostile sexism are more likely to endorse benevolent sexism and vice versa. So even though these attitudes have very different tones, one negative, one positive, they actually go hand in hand. They actually are resolved because people who are hostile sexist think, well, I dislike those feminists, but I love my mom, I love my sister, I love my wife, I love women who basically stay in traditional roles. Okay, so it's not actually psychologically conflicting. It resolves that conflict by saying, well, there's good women and there's bad women, and that really depends on how they fit in traditional roles or challenge traditional roles. Now, here's a really very interesting finding to me, and I was really kind of floored by it. We find consistently that if you look at the unit of analysis being national averages, so we consider the average for the U.S. compared to Chile, compared to other countries. We look at national averages. Hostile and benevolent sexism go together at a correlation that's close to 0.9, which is almost unheard of in social science research. So what this means is if a country, if a national sample on the whole scores relatively high compared to other national samples on hostile sexism, it will also score high on benevolent sexism, and vice versa. So you don't get a country where people are scoring high on benevolent sexism that doesn't also have hostile sexism. So at the cultural level, these two things are really virtually inseparable as cultural attitudes. If it's high on one, it's high on the other. Okay. So again, this sort of points to this notion of the carrot and the stick, that hostile and benevolent sexism serve as a coordinated system to help keep women cemented in their place. And of course, the system worked for millennia. In addition, benevolent sexism, like hostile sexism, actually predicts measures of gender inequality. So the United Nations measures in most of the countries across the world. This index, there's various indices, but I'm going to focus on the GEM, that assesses the percent of women and men versus men in powerful roles in business and government. So, for instance, how many women are in a parliament or a senate would go into this. So in the U.S., that would be about, I think, 17-19%. But it also looks at business across different kinds of things. So what do we find? Well, the national HS averages, so how high a nation scores on hostile sexism, and these are degree of negative correlation now that I'm graphing. I didn't know how to make the graph go the other way. So the national hostile sexism averages predict a lower GEM score. So in other words, the nations that are high in hostile sexism are structurally less equal. Women are objectively in a worse position in those nations. Now, what's really interesting is that, in addition to that, benevolent sexism predicts just as well. Although, again, the two go hand in hand, so that's almost inevitable. But benevolent sexism also predicts less actual gender equality. So this is one of the reasons why benevolent sexism is really problematic. And this is another interesting finding that we found. You can see that, and the blue bars are men's hostile sexism scores, and I've arranged the nations in order of how sexist they are. So the nations on the far left are the most sexist in terms of the samples we got. And these are not purely representative samples, but they give you an idea of just sort of relative ranking of nations. The red bars are women's scores, and you can see there is a gender gap. And actually, in every sample that we test, if you get a big enough sample, men score higher in hostile sexism than women, and that makes sense that women are not going to be as hostile toward their own group as men might be. But if you look at benevolent sexism, and still the nations are ordered in terms of men's scores, and you'll see it's pretty much a similar setup of nations. The ordering is very similar when you order by benevolent sexism. But now we see something very different. The gender gap tends to disappear for benevolent sexism. So here's something that's really problematic about benevolent sexism. Because it seems nice, it doesn't seem like prejudice. It has a subjectively positive, sugar-coated tone. Oftentimes women will endorse benevolent sexism just as much as men. It's nice to be thinking I will be put on a pedestal if I'm a woman. So you still sometimes see women scoring lower than men, but overall the gender gap tends to disappear. And in fact, we found this really interesting phenomenon of women kind of running ahead of the men in the most sexist nations. And I thought this is a really interesting effect, which I call the protection racket effect. And if you think about women in these highly sexist nations, remember these are where there's also high hostile sexism, then these women don't have a lot of choices. Structurally, they don't have as much opportunity. They live in a nation where men are more hostile and they're more at risk from men. And so what do you do? So this is where it's a protection racket. It's like when the mafia comes to your place of business and says, look, your business could burn down unless you pay us money for protection. Women are threatened in these nations by their lower status position relative to men. And who are the threat? The threat comes from men. Who do they seek protection from? Well, they seek protection from men. For men, you know, by men, from men, right? So you seek a male protector, perhaps a husband, a father, someone in your family who's going to protect you from other men. So that's the protection racket effect, and it shows that really in these nations, benevolent sexism has a kind of coercive sort of effect. Women are endorsing it and endorsing traditional values about gender, but they're doing that because really they don't have a choice. At least that's my interpretation. And some experimental studies have shown that when you tell women men in their nation are very hostile toward women, it bumps up their benevolent sexism scores. So it suggests that women are doing this kind of protectively. So this is, again, one of the insidious things about benevolent sexism, because it becomes a very attractive way for both sexes to justify the status quo, to justify inequality. For men, it's a very positive self-image to say that I am the protector and provider, right? That's a much better image than I'm an oppressor. And it actually legitimates the hostile sexist attitudes that men have, because if you call a man a sexist, he might laugh at you and say, well, you know, I'm not sexist. Yes, I don't like some women, but I love other women. So it makes it seem like, you know, it's okay, right? It legitimates the hostile side of sexism. For women, it promises that men will take care of you. It promises that men will provide, that men will be affectionate toward you, but again, this is a promise contingent upon fulfilling traditional female ideals. And it's a way of protecting yourself in an environment that might be hostile. So again, it can have it can be something that women leap to when they feel threatened. So both sexes might endorse it instead of women resisting it. That really makes this then something that is going to make it hard to change entrenched attitudes, because women themselves may not protest it. Okay, well, is it really, really on its own bad? This is what I'm going to start answering now. Benevolent sexism has effects that are not predictable from hostile sexism alone. and that's what I'm going to show you. There's a great study by Eden King and her colleagues where they looked at an actual industry, male-dominated industry, the energy industry, and they looked at people who had been in that industry and who had made it to management ranks, both men and women. These men and women reported on the feedback they had gotten during their own development. And what you see is an effect that seems very nice to women, right? Women received less, they reported receiving less negative developmental feedback than men. They got more praise, less negative feedback. But here's the kicker. When you look at the assignments they were given, they were given less challenging assignments. So that's the combination. You're being told, oh, you're wonderful, but I'm not going to give you a challenging assignment that might lead to developing your skills or to promotion, right? And that, it really is the essence of patronizing attitudes. It's like patting somebody on the head for being able to tie their shoelace. It means you think they're really not that competent, and you overpraise them when they do something that you treat them with kid gloves, essentially, but you don't promote them. Now, this was replicated in with managers in England's National Health Service as well. So this is an effect not just in one industry alone. Interestingly, King and her colleagues followed this up with some lab studies with undergraduates and MBA students. And they were assigned the role of a manager, and they were to give developmental opportunities to a male or female subordinate. And what they found is that for men who were high in benevolent sexism, they gave female subordinates less developmental opportunities. Okay, so high benevolent sexist men assigned less challenge to women. They didn't do this sort of thing to men. They did it selectively toward women. And so benevolent sexism score didn't affect men's treatment of men. And women did not show this kind of effect toward men. Okay, so you're giving people soft feedback, but really discriminating against them on what truly matters. And this has been replicated by Biernat and her colleagues, who looked at actual evaluations that were archival data that were kept by a Wall Street law firm. So a very tony Wall Street law firm, very competitive looking at how the junior associates were evaluated. And they found the same effect. Women were given more praise than men. So women are told, you're wonderful, you're great, okay? But on the numerical ratings, and this is important, the numerical ratings that they gave, rating them on various categories, were actually the things that went into the formula for deciding who was going to be promoted. So who's going to be on the partner track. On the numerical ratings, we see the reverse. Women are told they're wonderful, but they're given lower numerical ratings on the ratings that really count. Also, in spontaneous comments, sometimes the people evaluating these junior associates would say, oh, this person really is going to be partner material, and that would be a spontaneous comment. That kind of comment was made half as often for women in their evaluations than for men. So again, on the stuff that really matters and really shows who is valued, praise is cheap, right? We have Mother's Day, and we're like, oh, great, we love mom. But when it comes to giving the resources, giving the promotions and the resources, then we see discrimination against women. Okay, so that's from the point of view of how benevolent sexism harms women by limiting their opportunities. It also harms them by actually undermining their own performance. So Benoit Dardan and his colleagues in Belgium have done a series of really great studies. And they have a sort of typical paradigm that they've done in this, with women participating in a simulated job selection for a male-dominated firm, so it's like a chemistry or chemical producer. And they encounter a recruiter who's supposedly from this firm who says, well, look, this is a really male-dominated industry, and he suggests, well, a lot of the men at work, and he describes these hostile sexist attitudes. This is what they believe about women. And he describes things consistent, really taken from items on the hostile sexism scale that I showed you earlier. Or he says that most of the men have these benevolently sexist attitudes. And again, he doesn't label them as benevolently or hostile sexist attitudes, but he uses items, things that are based on items on the benevolent sexism scale. So they think it'll be nice to have women around. They'll help them out. They'll take care of them. They'll protect them, and so on. versus he doesn't make any sexist comments. So people are randomly assigned to condition between groups for one set of these comments. Now, what happened? Women then take a test, a cognitive test, that they're told is a common employment test to determine who's going to be successful and what your cognitive skills are. And what they found is that women are undermined when they've heard these benevolently sexist comments about this work environment. And they're uniquely undermined. Hostile sexism doesn't make them perform worse. And one of the reasons for this is that they really are reacting to, well, I'm going to show you, right? But benevolent sexism leads to, as we'll see, self-doubt, and it undermines performance. Okay, so it does it through self-doubt, and Dardan and his colleagues have shown that, look, people, women recognize when they hear the hostile sexist remarks, they recognize those as sexist, and that promotes resistance. I'm going to show you how good I am. Benevolent sexism is not recognized as sexist. So when they ask, was the recruiter sexist, among other questions that they ask them at the end, people who are in the benevolent sexism condition don't think the recruiter was sexist. In the hostile sexist condition, they say, yes, he was. Okay, in the benevolent sexist condition, it's the same as the control condition as far as any statistical difference. Okay, so what is it doing to these women? What Dardan and his colleagues showed through mediational analysis is when you look at the benevolent sexism in contrast to the hostile sexism condition, that it worsens performance, or it's associated with worse performance. It is also associated with more mental intrusions. So people report, women report, that they had a harder time kind of keeping their mind clear, and they had these sort of intrusive thoughts. They couldn't concentrate on the task as well. And it's those mental intrusions that actually undermine the performance. And when you account for the mental intrusions in a mediational analysis, all of a sudden it fully accounts for the performance decrement due to benevolent sexism. So it's really through these mental intrusions that women's performance worsens. Now, actually, Dardan has some colleagues. He's a social psychologist, but he got together with some neuroscientists. So I'm going to show you my one neuroscience study that was recently done and reported in Neuro Report, where they put people into the MRI machine, and they use that same job recruitment task. Okay, and so they saw written comments from this job recruiter about the place of employment. And they saw this before and during the fMRI scan. So women only were in this study. They were randomly assigned to see hostile sexist comments, benevolent sexist comments, or to a control condition with no sexist comments at all. And then they did a cognitive test inside the scanner to see what would happen. And the focus here was on areas in the brain that are known to be related to actively trying to suppress thoughts while you're doing a task. So trying to suppress extraneous thoughts to make you more focused on a task. So here's women's brain on benevolent sexism. And what they found is they found that the relative to the hostile sexism control condition, they found greater activation in these areas, the left anterior cingulate sulcus, the right middle frontal gyrus, and left and right pregenual anterior cingulate. I'm not a neuroscientist, but here we have some evidence that actually there were brain processes associated with trying to inhibit extraneous thoughts. So basically, women are really preoccupied by trying to get rid of these intrusive thoughts that include self-doubts about how good they are once they've been exposed to benevolent sexism, so they don't perform as well on cognitive tests. Now, in addition to this, there's another problem, a social problem for women, even if they recognize that they're being treated in a patronizing way. They are really then faced a dilemma. So in a study that I was a co-author on, we looked at a situation or created a situation, a scenario that we had the kind of pictures and storyboard for that we exposed people to, where a male coworker offers really a very patronizing offer of help with a male task or traditionally masculine task or stereotypically masculine task, technical task of setting up the network server on the computer. So here's what he says. That's not something you should hassle with. He sees his coworker, and we told people they were employed for the same amount of time. They were in the same level in the organization, same position. So he's got no special skills, right? And so he offers to do it for the woman, but explicitly saying it's not something a woman should have to do. We made it very much explicitly a sexist comment, a patronizing sexist comment. Okay, so what happened then next was that this was the manipulation of condition. The woman either accepted the offer, you don't see what happens to the rest of the scenario, so it ends before we know how the woman responds, so that's a control condition, or she rejects the offer. I don't know, my rejects seems not be in the bullet point, but yes, that was one of the conditions. She either rejects, accepts, and when she rejects it politely. She says, oh, no, thank you, I can do it myself. So what happens to perceptions of this woman? So now people are looking at this scenario from the outside and saying what they think of the woman. Okay, so what we found is that when this woman, we looked at two dimensions, right? Her perceived competence, is she able to do this task? And her perceived warmth, is she a nice person? Okay, so I'm going to focus on these two dimensions that really are central dimensions to how we evaluate other people. And what we found was that when she accepted the man's help, she was seen as less competent. So that's the red bar relative to the gray one, that's the control condition. If she declined help, then this boosts her competence relative to we don't know what happened, we don't know whether she's going to accept or decline help. And this makes sense. If I accept help, I'm admitting I can't do it myself. If I decline help, I'm stating that I can do it myself. What about warmth? Well, here we found the opposing trends, right? And they're all significant. When she rejects the help, politely rejects the help, she is seen as less warm. So she is not seen as a nice person relative to the control condition. When she accepts the help and says, oh yeah, please do it for me, people see her as warmer. So here's the dilemma. If you reject the help, you'll be seen as competent, but not warm. And this is really consistent with a lot of research on when women are competent in masculine domains, they are often really penalized on that warmth dimension. They're seen as not nice. All right. So you can be seen as competent and not warm if you reject the help, or you can accept the help and be polite, and you'll be seen as warm, but you won't be seen as competent, so you're facing a trade-off. Okay, well, what happens if we do this with a man? We did run this this scenario as well, because we wanted to compare it, and it even seems kind of weird if a woman comes up and says, oh, the network server, a man shouldn't have to have that frustration, I'll do it for you. But we ran that, and we saw what people thought. And what we found is that on the competence dimension, we got the same effects. If a man accepts help, he's seen as less competent. If he rejects help, he's seen as more competent. So that's not a sexist effect. That's really an effect that was true for both female targets of benevolent kind of patronizing help and male targets. All right. But on the warmth dimension, that's where we get a difference. On the warmth dimension, he doesn't get any penalty for refusing help. And this is why men won't ask for directions or anything like that. They don't like to ask for help, because we know if we ask for help, we'll be seen as less competent, less manly, and we won't get any benefit. People aren't going to see us as nicer or warmer. They're just going to, it's all negative. Women face the dilemma. They can reject the help, but then they're not going to be seen as warm. Men don't have that dilemma. So this is really a problem when you're faced with benevolent sexism. What do you do? It's a really tricky situation where you really have to preserve the person who's offering help, preserve their feelings while you're refusing the help. So what can we do about this? That's the focus of the rest of my talk, and then we'll get to questions. Well, first off, one thing I want to do is just sort of have you recognize that benevolent sexism exists, because it's often really not something that people understand what it is, or maybe women have experienced it, but they couldn't really put their finger on articulating that it's really sexist or why it's such a problem. Okay, so individually and institutionally, I think this is one of those cases where just recognizing the problem is an advance, because it's often been seen simply as niceness and not as a problem. And when you recognize the problem, then we can do more monitoring of our own behavior. So if you're mentoring students, are you treating male students differently from female students? Are you going easy on female or minority students because you're worried they can't handle it, which is a form, again, of patronizing, because if you don't give them developmental feedback that's really critical or don't give them challenging opportunities, then you really are undervaluing them, even as you think you're maybe being nice. One thing that we found in social psychology that's really, really important for women and minorities in fields that they typically or that they traditionally were excluded from is that they are very, very sensitive to clues that people think they don't belong, or even just to passive clues that they don't belong. So even one study showed that if the computer science lab is decorated with geek decor, like Star Trek posters, Mountain Dew cans, and technical magazines, women feel less welcome than if it's decorated with more neutral decor. So when you're surrounded by people who are not members of your group, you're already very sensitive then, sensitized to this idea that maybe I don't belong with this crowd. So those kinds of cues can be really, really damaging, and it's one of the things that we can be more sensitive about without being patronizing about it. But the thing I'm going to focus on most is something that you can do in mentoring and teaching. So if you're, whether you're in an organization, a business organization or an academic institution, you probably are mentoring other people or teaching them in some capacity. And this is where it's very easy to become patronizing and hard to understand how you should avoid it. So there's some really good research on what's called wise mentoring and teaching that I want to describe to you, because I think it's really, really useful in combating this kind of benevolent prejudice. So what is wise mentoring? Well, Jeff Cohen and his colleagues have looked at this in the context of race, but also in the context of gender. But the most studies that they've done have really been looking at black and white students, so minority students in college. They had them in this study that they said was a study about teaching experiences, or experiences of being a student and having a teacher that was influential. And they were asked to write very carefully, construct a letter that commended their most influential teacher. And they were told that the best letter is actually going to be published in an education journal, so that this was going to be a prestigious thing. And these were students at Stanford, so these were students at a really, really good school. They received critical feedback on their essay a week later. So they were told, we're going to look at your essay, we're going to make comments on it, give you critical feedback. They came back and they saw the feedback. And they received criticism that was actually standardized. Those of you who teach a lot, I've been teaching for close to 30 years, so you realize like you're making a lot of similar comments really apply to a lot of kids' papers. So they received criticism that seemed probably to them to be very specific and tailored to them, and I'll show you some examples, but it was actually standardized, all right? And then in addition to this very critical feedback that they got, very kind of harsh, high standard feedback, they got another message about the kind of standards that were being imposed, or they additionally got this assurance that the person who was criticizing their work thought that they really could revise this into something that was going to be really great and publishable. So here's the critical feedback. It was things like your examples were insufficiently vivid, you were kind of rambling on in the middle part and vague, right? Things like that. And so this letter then, the rest of this then in a condition where it added the high standards. So some people just got the critical feedback. Some people got the critical feedback plus the high standards. The person said, look, this letter is okay for a first effort, but I am judging it by a really, really high standard for publication in a journal. And so those are the standards that I'm imposing. So you have to read the feedback in light of those critical standards. And then a third group, based on random assignment, got not only the critical feedback and the high standards message, but additionally this assurance message that, look, the reason I am giving you all of this feedback, and I went to the trouble of giving you so much feedback and being so critical, is because I really believe you can reach the higher standard. All right, so this was sort of geared toward people who might think, well, maybe I just don't belong here. Maybe that assurance would be very important to them. So what happened? The stuff on the left is really the old bullet points that I showed you. Here's the results. When they got just this harsh criticism, right, the black students later in rating whether they thought the critic was biased or not, were much more likely than the white students to think that they were subjected to discrimination of some sort, that there was some sort of bias on the part of the critic. When they got the high standards message, this was reduced, and they were more like the white students. But when they got the standards and the reassurance, look, I really think you can do this, that was the condition in which black students perceive the least bias. So they don't think they're really facing bias. So this really undermines the perception of bias because they then interpret this criticism as, look, this person is being harsh and has high standards, but they really believe I can do it and they're trying to help me get to that higher standard. In addition, they looked at task motivation. So if you look on the right here, the other graph, what they found was that when you had the criticism plus the standards plus the reassurance, that is when black students showed high motivation to continue on this task, to revise this letter, to shoot for publication. And it really turned around the black students. So if you look at those bars, you can see that when they just got criticism or they got criticism and said, well, look, I'm imposing high standards, they really were turned off relatively. But when they got the assurance that I think you can do it along with it, then they were motivated to really rise up to the challenge. So this, together with the findings about perceived rater bias, really add up to providing that sort of high-level criticism, not backing off, not patronizing, using high standards, but making sure that you reassure that I believe you can do it. You were admitted here for a reason. You were hired here for a reason. You will develop. That's why I'm investing in you with all this feedback. That seems to work. And in fact, although they didn't publish this, I talked to Jeff Cohen about it. He has similar data on women in STEM fields. So this same sort of effects with large increases. They were given like a scientific presentation they had to do and then critical feedback on it. And after that critical feedback with high standards and reassurance that I think you can do it, they showed increases in motivation. So you don't have to soft pedal the feedback, but you do have to assure the person that you really believe in them. And it's especially true, again, with women and minorities because they're already sort of doubting whether they belong because they don't, you know, they see a lot of cues that I'm not the sort of person that seems to belong here. So what are the lessons from wise mentoring? Again, don't patronize. There's no need to soft pedal, all right? But you have to be very sensitive to these environmental threats that people, that women and minorities are experiencing. And so those can be really undermining. They can lead to self-doubt that decreases performance. They can also lead to then disengaging from the field, dropping out. So for women, this kind of personal criticism really has a group-based belonging threat. What they hear is, look, your group sucks at this. And of course, this is not, I don't advocate this kind of feedback, but I saw this cartoon and it sort of fit. Okay. So coupling that harsh feedback or that critical feedback with the belongingness kind of message and that you can do it is really, really important to maintaining and increasing motivation and performance. This also can happen in the classroom, not only when you're grading papers, but here's another study. Mary Murphy has been doing some really, really interesting work on teaching, and she has applied a book that I would recommend everybody read by Carol Dweck. Carol Dweck's a developmental psychologist at Stanford. She's done a lot of research on different theories we have. Different kind of, just sort of our own psychology theories that we carry around with us, even if we're not psychologists, about abilities. And so there are different lay theories of ability. One is the theory that, look, basically you're talented or you're not. You're born with a talent and you can develop that talent maybe, but basically, you know, look, some people are always going to be bad at some tasks and some people are gifted and it's the gifted people we want then in our organizations. That sort of belief, that sort of fixed, that abilities are fixed, it turns out to be really damaging. It's really damaging in a lot of ways. It's actually damaging to the people who hold them about themselves, because when they encounter failure at any level, then it really threatens their beliefs that they have what it takes, and so they tend to disengage. It's also really damaging, it turns out, when it's communicated by your teacher that they have this general idea that it's that ability is fixed. Because for women in fields that they're not that they traditionally haven't been in, this fixed belief, when it's communicated, is interpreted as my teacher thinks that really men are the ones who have talent in this field. This is contrasted with a malleable theory, which turns out to be really good in all sorts of ways. Kids who have this malleable theory about themselves, when they fail, they say, oh, well, I just haven't learned this enough yet, so I have to try harder. Kids with a fixed theory say, oh, I failed, I'm threatened, they psychologically are threatened, I might not be as smart as I thought I was, I'm not going to try because I don't want to get confirmation that I'm not this great talent. So, but when the teacher has this kind of idea, it's communicated that, look, I think you're going to grow and improve, and that's why I'm giving you feedback, for instance, so you can grow and improve, and that people will get better over time if they work at it. Now, it turns out that students, if you ask them, even if they've been in a classroom a week, they have a pretty good idea of which theory their teacher has. Right, so the teachers sort of communicate this in all sorts of ways. The classic look to the left, look to the right. The third of you or half of you are going to be gone tends to suggest a fixed theory, right, versus a malleable theory. So teachers actually communicate these in various ways. How does this affect women in STEM fields? Well, here's the dependent variable here is belonging. How much do I feel like I belong? Well, it turns out that when the teacher is perceived as having one of these fixed theories, the green bar, as opposed to a malleable theory of talent, women do feel they belong less, which tends to lead to less motivation. So this was true in a public university, also true in a polytechnical school. The one exception was at a women's college, where then it probably did not carry that kind of group threat, right? So it didn't happen there. But it did happen when women were mixed in with men. Okay, so how we teach and mentor can really make a difference. So that's like sort of my big message here in terms of how you might combat things. We can motivate and engage women and minorities in STEM fields, and we can maintain standards. We don't have to bend our standards. We shouldn't bend our standards. But we should communicate that people belong and that we think that they can develop and that where they start is not where they're going to end up. And giving that sort of personal investment and assurance, again, not overdoing it, right? But giving that assurance that, we think you will be the sort of person who will succeed. It may take a lot of work and you're not going to be there at the beginning. That is really, really valuable. So, before I turn to questions, I just want to say that you can do this. You can employ these kinds of principles, and it can have a really a big effect on your students, maybe some of whom or your colleagues who might otherwise think that they might withdraw or be less motivated. So I am now going to turn to, I see we have like 11 minutes left, or maybe we can have more, but I'm going to turn to the questions and answers. And let's see, I'll read these questions, trying to see if I can expand the question. Okay, so here's the first question I see is, do you think that when more women enter a profession, its economic value falls? There is some research on that, and I think it's been kind of mixed. I'm not really enough, I couldn't give you a definitive answer on that. But there is some evidence that can happen. There's so many things that go into affecting salaries and economic value. For instance, nursing right now is a relatively good field to be in, even though it's still highly female. because there's a lot of demand for it. But I think that the research shows that maleness is what we call a diffuse status characteristic. So it tends to be associated with higher status, and there may be some economic effect. But I can't give you a really definitive answer on that question. I've seen kind of conflicting results on that. Okay, this next question asks about objectification of women. How does objectification of women, for instance, through pornography, to be answered. All right, so objectification of women, I'll just address that question. I can't see the rest of it. I need to figure out how I can expand those questions. But so objectification of women has been studied. When women are objectified, even in ways that are really common in our society, for instance, if you show men commercials that feature bikini-clad models, even though these are commercials that are just regularly on television, versus commercials with more neutral content, you know, one beer commercial with horses versus bikini-clad models, it does affect how they interact with women. And it also, what it tends to do is it tends to spark greater sexual attraction if they view a woman as attractive. And so it really can enhance the benevolent sexism aspect of this, because that's part of that intermittent interdependence is romantic attraction. So it tends to increase sexual and romantic motives. And so men have this kind of approach toward women who are being, after they are primed with objectifying women, but they don't value their competence. And in fact, you get weird effects. For instance, one study found that that after men were primed with these TV commercials and they interacted with a woman in a work-like context where they had to interview the woman, well, they sat closer. They were more doing behaviors that sort of bordered on kind of sexually harassing. And they also were doing this at supposedly it's like a job-like interview. They were more likely to recommend this woman for this job, which is an entry-level position, but they saw her as less competent, right? So here's the thing about benevolent sexism. It may have sometimes these kind of tangible benefits. Oh, yeah, we should hire her, but if you're hiring her as eye candy, you're not respecting her and you're not respecting her competence, and she's going to be stuck in a lower level position. So objectification of women goes along with this, and it really is something that is problematic. Okay, I'm seeing how I can look at this question more fully. So I'm sorry for the questions I've already answered. I wasn't able to look at them more fully, but I'm gonna answer this one. I'm female and have found that my male bosses and advisors have given me a lot more opportunity and guidance than my female bosses and advisors. I found many of my female bosses to actively stand in the way of my professional development to the point of aggressive hostility. There is some research you might want to look up on what's called the queen bee effect. So remember I showed you at the beginning that women can discriminate against women just as men can discriminate against women. And yes, sometimes individual women may discriminate actually more than men do. And so the queen bee effect is that women who have kind of come up through the ranks, especially in a field where they faced a lot of possible cues that they don't belong, where they maybe have faced hostility and discrimination, but they've made it through their own grit and determination, may adopt an attitude that, look, I had to deal with all that stuff, and I made it, and they've sort of adapted by sort of adopting the norms of the field. So they've kind of toughened themselves up. And so that's their model, right? So they may, in fact, see other women as, they're the exception, right? I'm the exception. Other women aren't tough enough. They aren't able to adapt to this field and actually be harsher on them than men. So there is some research on this. I would say that in general, women are more likely to face discrimination in very masculine fields, and it can come from both men and women who have made it to the top of those fields. But in general, I think the research would suggest that men are more likely to discriminate than women are, but I'm not, but there is this notion of the queen bee effect, and you can look up some research on that. Okay, the next question is, what are some effective methods a woman can employ to alter sexism in the workplace? So that's a big question. It's hard to alter a system, right? It's hard to do that, and you're sort of trying to negotiate it yourself. I think that that having open discussions about this is can be a good thing, but it can also lead to a lot of reaction. We know, for instance, that in general, people are hostile toward people who are seen as complaining about things, and that's people who even have been obviously discriminated against often are viewed as complaining if they raise that. So the system is sort of often set up to really ostracize people who are kind of activists, if it's really kind of an entrenched system. I think, if you have sympathetic ears that you can talk to in your organization who have some power, that's really hugely important. The organizations that really effectively combat sexism and other prejudices are ones where the people at the top really, really want to change the situation. So when you have buy-in and commitment at the top of the organization, that tends to be really more effective, and when they show that they really do have this as a priority, then that can really, really help. The other thing is, lots of times people are well-meaning, and a lot of discrimination happens without their even thinking about it or their awareness of it. And so when you have people who you have a good sense that they really do have the right values and are well-meaning, then you can find ways maybe to talk to them about things that you think maybe are problematic without really suggesting that you're a bad person, right? Because people get very reactive when they think they're being attacked or told that they did something bad. So you have to find ways, I think, to talk about it where you're not seen as blaming another individual or saying that there's something wrong with them, but pointing out some things that maybe could be done better. Okay. So here's a question. Why did the white student performance suffer when they're subjected to the "I think you can do it" reassurance? Right, so I can kind of go back to that slide, I think. Let's see if this is it. So task motivation. Now this is task motivation relative to a baseline. Did it increase? Here, I don't know that difference was really statistically significant. The white students are kind of, in that first and third condition, kind of really hovering very close to zero, which is really no change in motivation. So again, this was controlling for initial motivation. I mean, I believe that was not statistically significant, so that in that third condition, that they weren't actually suffering from that condition. And I don't think it's a sort of effect that replicated in terms of any sort of negative effect. So I'd have to go back and look at the study more carefully to be sure about that, but I think that's the case. Okay. And then I think this is a similar sort of question about the first slide. Maybe that's perceived. Oh no, this is also about the task motivation. So I think I've actually answered that question already. Okay. There's another question. Is there any evidence that giving additional challenges to women transmits a sense of investment, acts as a belonging cue, or is that being perceived as being picked on or marked for failure? This is a really interesting question, right? I mean, you can get, I know that Terry Vecchio at Penn State has been investigating this sort of, when a woman is competent, she might be used, given a lot of assignments, because the skills are recognized. And remember that, maybe I didn't really talk about it in this presentation exactly, but the competence is something that people tend not to be as discriminatory on when there is obvious evidence. So when you have skills that can be demonstrated. So for instance, let me just give you an example. If we're at the archery range And I think women are less good archers than men, but you come up and you get five bullseyes in a row, I am not going to deny your competence, right? It's very hard to deny competence when there are obvious indicators. And that's not always the case that there are obvious indicators of competence, but often in work situations, there may be. And so people don't discriminate as much then on competence, but they will discriminate on this warmth dimension, which is way more fuzzy. And so they might use the competent person to get things done without any intention of really rewarding them for it. It's really more a matter of exploitation. So I think the difference between that, I don't know of any research that's really picked that apart. That would be really difficult to do. So I think it really depends on the situation. And I think that that may happen sometimes, that giving additional challenges is really just a way of exploiting the person versus giving them opportunities. So I think the key to that is understanding whether these opportunities or these challenges are being given with the idea towards doing something that will lead to promotion or not, right? I think that's really the key thing. Okay, so I'm going to answer this as the last question, I think, here. This question says, does that mean if a girl was educated and grew up in a women-dominant environment, such as a girls' school, girls' college, she's likely to have been exposed to less bias and be more competent? Yeah, I think there is truth to that, that when women especially, if you want women to go into STEM fields, for instance, that they do benefit from being insulated from men in college, for instance, because then it doesn't become tagged as a male field in their immediate environment. Those are very powerful social norms when in the immediate environment, all you see is fellow women doing this field. Now, what happens when you graduate and then you go out into the world where you might face more bias? That may be a problematic transition. And it's interesting overall that girls in general tend to do better than boys now in school in the US, for instance, up through college. Girls are facing an environment in schools where they are expected to excel, and maybe they're facing less bias than when they get out into the wider world. So, and they may find that kind of a rude awakening. But it also gives you a chance to really consolidate and hone your skills. And so there may be a benefit to that. I'm not advocating that we should have gender segregated education. I think, you know, we need to address things like the belonging cues, and we need eventually to all be together. But there can be an insulation. And again, the question to me is, what happens when then you move on to the next phase and you aren't insulated in that way? And one thing that people have found about when these stereotype and belonging threats come in, it can come in at any level, even after you've invested a lot in a career or a direction that you've headed in. So you could see people maybe dropping out in graduate school if they've been insulated before that, but they haven't faced this until graduate school. So really at any level that those threats can really undermine women. All right, well, I think that's all the questions. I apologize to the ones that I hadn't figured out exactly how to read all of them. But I'd like to thank you for attending this. And also, if you want continuing education credits, there is the address to go to. So thanks very much.